For most of us, it starts with God. In the words of the first hymn in our hymnal, immortal, invisible, God only wise, in light inaccessible, hid from our eyes, most blessed, most glorious, ancient of days, almighty, victorious, your great name we praise. It's quite a hymn, and appropriate, the lofty poetry which we sing about, or we use to talk about God, the great mystery who can never be fully captured in any language, any image or thought, but is best understood, we say, in progressive Christianity, maybe through the philosophy of panentheism and process theology. Now, I preached about that last week, so if you were not here, then I would encourage you to go to our website and hear the first of these series of sermons. Because, yes, it begins with God, but then what? What comes next? What difference do our beliefs about God make in our everyday lives? Well, enter Jesus Christ. In the words of the Apostle Paul, when the fullness of time had come, God sent Jesus Christ. Suddenly, divine mystery had a name. Who is Jesus Christ? Now, the answer to that question has always been crucial to Christian faith. Even Jesus, according to the Synoptic Gospels, once posed the question to his own disciples. Who do people say I am? He asked them. And then more personally, he asked, who do you say I am? And that question still leaps across the centuries, and it sets down right before us today. What do we believe about Jesus Christ? Now, in our traditions, in answering any question like that, no one can speak for anyone else. Each of us must decide. Proxy votes are not allowed here. So as you ponder this important matter, progressive Christianity would like to suggest to you that there may indeed be three Jesuses. First, there is the Jesus of history, or what Marcus Borg called the pre-Easter Jesus. Now, this first Jesus includes all the scholarly attempts to try and create a historical biography of the Jewish man from Nazareth. For nearly three centuries now, scholars have known that many of the stories about Jesus in the Gospels are actually stuff of legend and mythology. They were stories that were borrowed and modified from Jewish and pagan cultures. For example, the birth stories of Jesus, whether in Matthew or in Luke's Gospel, they sound very much like the birth story of the Egyptian god Horus, who was also born of a virgin mother. And also his birth was heralded by angels. And then there's the ancient Persian religion that celebrated the birth of the sun god Mithra. When? On December the 25th. And there were stories about wandering stars and wise men. Even the birth story of the Buddha, with its miraculous story of angels and kings, sounds a whole lot like the Jesus story. Most of the miracle stories of Jesus in the Gospels, whether walking on water or turning water to wine, these were well-known legends in the ancient world. And early Christians who would join the movement would apply these stories to Jesus to elevate his importance and to promote his divinity. Now, modern scholarship has been able to strip away the later layers of devotion and theology to try and discover the Jesus of history, that first century Jew from a small impoverished village who took the title rabbi, surrounded himself with learners, refined his religion, altered conventional views of morality. He spoke truth to power. He embodied a life of love to such an extent that the poor felt blessed. Outcasts felt included. Women were dignified. Sinners were forgiven. Peacemakers were encouraged. But religious and political authorities felt threatened. And the rich were challenged to share. So the consensus view among scholars today is that Jesus, the historical Jesus, the man, he never claimed to be God or the only Son of God or even the Savior of the world. But the presence of God was the central reality and experience of his life. He and God were one. And his message, it wasn't about the end of the world or about getting to heaven. It was about what he called the basilia, the reign, the kingdom of God, here and now in this world. What life would look like if God were truly allowed to be in charge. And Jesus, he didn't see his primary work as dying for the sins of others. He died because his teachings and his ministry challenged religious and political powers, very much what happened to Gandhi or to Martin Luther King Jr., who died for their just causes. Indeed, Jesus was a Jewish mystic. He experienced the sacredness of life in himself and everywhere, and he taught a countercultural wisdom. He said, God's character is compassion. God's passion is for justice in the world. God's not about judging. God's not about purity. And so we say the Lord's Prayer. He taught disciples about the coming kingdom of God. And it deals with bread and debt, which were two of the basic survival issues for peasants of his day. Clearly, the kingdom is not fully here yet, as long as there are systems of domination in place. And so Jesus responded to those systems of domination with active nonviolence. And from him, Gandhi and Martin Luther King learned. And when he said to his disciples, "Do not resist evil," he didn't mean be a doormat, but rather do not resist evil with violence. Resistant, yes, but do it in nonviolent ways. Compassion, mercy, practicing justice. These are to be the primary ethical strategies of Jesus' followers. Be compassionate, he said, as God is compassionate. Now, this historical Jesus is important. He has inspired all kinds of good in the world. He started a movement that became the church and Christianity. But somewhere along the way, the church lost most of what the historical Jesus was about. How did that happen? Well, that leads us to the second Jesus, the one most people are familiar with, the post-Easter Jesus, the Christ of faith and creeds and Christian theology that took faith and belief and turned this first century Jewish Jesus into an absolute and unique revelation of God. Christian theology created doctrines like incarnation, atonement, Trinity, that mysterious dogma that no Christian really understands. And as a result, for most Christians, Jesus and Christ are synonymous. It's as if Christ is Jesus' last name. This second Jesus, this Christ of faith, has spawned many different theologies or Christologies, even in the Bible. In the Gospel of Matthew, Peter confesses that Jesus, you are the Christ, although he's got a very different idea from Jesus what that means. But in John's Gospel, Christ is the divine Logos that existed before the creation of the world. And then you read Paul's, the letter to the epistle to the Colossians. It talks about a cosmic Christ in whom all things are held together. So these words suggest that Jesus Christ is a metaphor for the divine spirit that permeates everything. In other words, Christ is not a person, but a power, a divine energy. It was in Jesus, but it's in us too. And it connects everything together. Christ is our Christian word for God. Just as Buddha is for Buddhists, or Ramakrishna is for Hindus, or Lao Tzu for Taoists. In the year 325, 300 bishops accepted Emperor Constantine's invitation to come participate in the first churchwide council at Nicaea. They thought, when they finished, that they had written an all-sufficient creed to explain what Christians believe about Jesus Christ. But before the ink was even dried on the parchment, there were people protesting and demanding the creed be changed. And so there followed, over hundreds of years, more councils, more creeds, heresy trials. If only they could have recognized that any one belief is always partial, that we shouldn't try and force anyone to believe exactly the same way we do. The biggest trap with the second Jesus, this Christ of faith, is that Christians end up adoring Jesus and forgetting that Jesus never said, "Worship me." He said, "Follow me." You know, it would take, this is amazing, it would take 1,800 years of Christianity before a group of ministers, our congregational ancestors, dared to suggest that the Jesus of history and the Christ of faith are not identical. And that leads us to the third Jesus, the one who lives in you and in me. Who is Jesus Christ? Christ is the divine potential in each of us to live the kind of life that God created and intended all of us to live. Jesus models for us a divine-centered life. What kind of life is that? Well, it's a life dedicated to truthfulness, relentless in the making of peace, one that foregoes retaliation or holding judgments in favor of building relationships, lives that exhibit humility, not arrogance, that practice the spiritual disciplines, knowing they're just as necessary to a healthy life as eating or drinking or exercising. It's a life that's persistent in well-being for everyone, even in the face of rejection and hatred. And the Easter story that's so central to the Christ story, it's really not about life after death. It's God's assurance that if what happened to Jesus were to happen to us, if by being faithful to the way of Jesus and the call of God ends up getting us in trouble or ridiculed or rejected or, God forbid, even killed, it's never the end of our life story. Sacrifices for God's way of love, peace, and justice in the world and on this earth, they will always continue to bear fruit. This is how the Spirit of Christ saves us. It leads us into what the John's Gospel calls an eternal, abundant way of living. So being a Christian is about personal transformation, about discovering our Christ-likeness and transforming the world. It's a lifelong journey. And one person who seemed to understand that is Albert Schweitzer. And you know, in my class, the younger generations don't always know who Albert Schweitzer is. I think it's important that we continue to keep his legacy alive, because for me, he captured the essential nature of Christ-likeness as few people have. This was a multi-talented human being, a world-class organist, a medical doctor, a humanitarian, a first-rate Bible scholar, and a person who won the Nobel Peace Prize. As one of the darlings of Europe's elite, he chose to divest himself of honor and popularity in order to serve the sickest and the poorest people in a little out-of-the-way African village, Lambaréen. As a scholar of the historical Jesus, Schweitzer understood that Jesus was more than just a historical character. He is our model. He saw that the only way to really know Christ is to follow the ways of Jesus. The only way to understand the meaning of Jesus' life is to practice his teachings. So whatever you do or don't believe about Jesus Christ, Don't let it distract you from your essential life purpose, and that is to find your own Christ consciousness, to have your own experience of the oneness with God. Others may not come and bow down and worship you as a Messiah, but what a beautiful world this would be if everyone was a Christ, one to another. I pray we let that be what we believe about Jesus Christ.